I do research on environmental justice. Environmental justice, it's really a way of bringing the social back into what an environmental problem is. You can't separate human beings from our environment. So where we find communities that are marginalized by income, by race, by cultural factors, by religion, by citizenship status, by nationality, we tend to find more often than not that those same socially marginalized communities are facing a disproportionate burden of environmental harm. This has happened in community after community after community. In Southern California, there is a community of Oxnard, California. Well, in that community, in addition to pesticide poisoning that these farm workers are dealing with, they recently were facing a fourth power plant proposal. They already host three power plants. Now, why is this an issue of environmental justice? Because the vast majority of this community is low income and immigrant. And so these are folks who are already vulnerable, not feeling terribly empowered, and not feeling respected when the government and a few corporations come together and say, we're essentially going to poison your air, and poison your air to produce power that will be generated for other communities. People's health will be compromised because of chemicals and pollutants coming out of this power plant. They're not getting any of the benefits. They're getting almost none of the jobs and getting zero electricity that's being produced by this contaminating machine. We've used statistical methods, we've done interviews, we've done observations, we've done historical archival data, and case after case after case, we find that it's not random that communities of color, low-income communities, immigrant communities, and indigenous communities across the United States tend to be in closer proximity to, or even playing host to, a variety of hazardous sites. One might ask, why do we see this pattern of environmental inequality, of environmental injustice? And the research seems to suggest quite strongly that there are a number of reasons. We see policymakers making decisions that appear to be cold and calculating, but really are quite rational in the sense that they are looking to follow the path of least resistance. And the path of least resistance generally means that communities that don't have high voting turnout, that communities that don't have friends in high places, that communities that don't have deep pockets, and communities that aren't always turning out at public hearings, those communities matter less. Those communities, more often than not, simply don't have the networks that gives them access to city council, to state government, to the national government. These are communities that tend to be made up of residents who don't serve on and are not asked to serve on county commissions, zoning boards, and other powerful decision-making bodies. Their interests are simply not represented in those halls of government where the decisions about where to put these power plants, these incinerators, these garbage dumps are being made. That social inequality in the ways in which we've distributed our environmental harm is evident everywhere you go. I was on the south side of Chicago studying a community organization. It was surrounded by toxic industries on 360 degrees. They called the community the toxic donut because everywhere you looked, there were toxic industries. Thousands and thousands of pounds of toxic contaminant chemicals being pumped into the air, the land, the water in this community. The environment is not just something out there. The oceans, the water, the land. the rivers, the belugas and the whales and the spotted owls. It is that, but it is also every place and every space where you and I, as human beings, as members of societies, live, recreate, work, learn. So, in schools, workplaces, and homes, those are part of the environment. It is inseparable from the oceans, from the rivers, from the streams, etc. We need our life support systems, our ecosystems, our water, our air, our soil, to be healthy, for us to be healthy. Environmental solutions absolutely have to involve technical expertise, scientific expertise, but they also have to involve basic common sense and inclusion and grassroots democratic community empowerment.